Welcome to Plants and Python. In this video, we're going to learn how to download Anaconda and get going with Jupyter notebooks. The first step, of course, is to download and install Anaconda. With Anaconda will come Python, Jupyter, and a number of Python modules that are necessary for us to do analyses. Go to docs.anaconda.com/anaconda/install. This link will be in the YouTube description for this video. This link might change with time, but if you can find Anaconda and where to download it and install it, there should always be instructions. Once on the installation page, click on the link for your operating system. For example, if you're using Windows, click on Installing on Windows, and there will be detailed instructions for download and install. The same for Mac OS, as well as for Linux. Once you have followed the instructions, downloaded and installed Anaconda, you should be able to load Jupyter. To load Jupyter on Mac OS or Linux, there's an application called Terminal that gets you to the terminal. On Windows, you need to go to the command prompt. Once you're at the command line, simply type Jupyter, and remember, there's a Y, not an I, it's Jupyter with a Y, space, notebook, and press Enter. Jupyter should load. It will load up in your browser. I'm using Chrome, for example. Jupyter is not using the internet. It's running locally on your own computer, and it's just using the browser to display the interface. The Jupyter interface shows you your home directory or whatever directory you've chosen for it to display. Once you're here at the Jupyter interface, you can go to the right-hand corner under New and create a new notebook. You can click on the title at the top and give it a name. You can say My Jupyter Notebook for a name, for example, and rename it. And Jupyter notebooks consist of cells. Cells are everything that a Jupyter notebook is, so it's important to be able to create them and to delete them. Some really convenient shortcuts are A, B, and X. A and B will create a new cell above or below. So if you click on the left side of the cell near the blue bar and you press A, you'll create a cell above. If you press B, you'll create a new cell below. And it's easy to create as many cells as you want. And importantly, X is a convenient way to delete a cell. There are two main types of cells in Jupyter. There are coding cells and there are markdown cells. By default, the cells are coding, and you can change them up here on this drop-down menu. Right now it's a coding cell, but we can change it to a markdown cell. Notice that when we create a markdown cell that the little prompt on the left goes away. You can also use shortcuts to convert between coding and markdown cells. You use M to change it to markdown, and you press Y to change it back to coding. You're going to learn all about how to create variables and how to code in the coming lessons, but let's just do some very simple code to just see how Jupyter works. Let's create code to calculate the area of a circle. Creating variables in Jupyter is easy. You just pick a name. Once you pick a name, you use the equal sign to assign them a value. Values assigned to variables can either be strings of characters, they're called strings, or they can be numbers. Let's create a string of characters first. To create a string, you always use quotation marks, and let's set the value to pi is a number. That is what our variable pi will be. Once you put your code in your cell, you need to execute the cell. You need to tell the cell to process the code that is in it. To execute a cell, all you do is you press Shift Enter. You can see that a number appears saying that our cell has been processed and a new cell appears below. Maybe we want to double check that, in fact, pi is set to the value pi is a number. So we simply type pi alone and we press Shift Enter. And the output, what is returned to us by Jupyter, is pi is a number. So we had set pi to that string. Maybe though we really want pi to actually be a number, so we just write again pi equals 3.14159 and we press shift enter. Again, we want to see, has pi been assigned the correct value? And it is now 3.14159. Notice that it's very easy for us to create a variable, but it's also very easy for us to write over a variable. And notice too that the order that we execute cells matters. This will be important later when you're writing code, that the order that you execute the cells is the code that you're executing, and it affects the assignment of values to variables, and that very much can affect your code. So order does matter. Let's create some more variables. Let's create a variable r for radius, set it equal to 1. Something that's very important in coding is commenting. If you use the hashtag, any characters or writing after the hashtag will not be processed by Python. It's a convenient way to leave comments in your code and help guide you in the future of what your code actually meant. So we should get into the practice of using coding often. Let's remind us what this variable was. We can say r is radius. You can create multiple lines of code within one cell. Let's create another variable. We'll call it a for area. It matters whether something is lowercase or uppercase, so you have to keep track of that. And if this is the area of the circle, let's say that it is pi times r squared. And notice then one asterisk is for multiplication, two asterisks is for exponents. So we can hit shift enter. We have assigned a value to r, and using r and pi, we then have calculated a. So let's see what a is equal to. And the area of our circle is equal to 3.14159, as we would expect. When you have code, it's really easy with variables to reassign their values. And this way, it's really easier to tinker with things and do calculations. That's one of the powers of coding. So let's give an arbitrary number with a complicated decimal to our radius. And if we recalculate the area of the circle now, we can see that it's a much more different and complicated number. As you saw, math is trivial and easy to do in Python. Plus is to create a sum. Hyphen is to subtract. As you saw, asterisk is for multiplication. Backslash is for division. As you saw, a double asterisk is for exponents. There's also things called Boolean statements in computing that are very important. Boolean statements can evaluate only to true or false. These are statements that create conditions that can only be said to be true or false. For example, maybe we want to say that 3 is greater than or equal to pi. That is not true because 3 is less than pi, but if we evaluate this statement, it comes out as false. So if we now say a Boolean statement of 3 is less than or equal to pi, that statement will be true. And if we said 3.14159 is not equal to pi, that statement is false because 3.14159 is equal to pi. We could say 3.14159 is double equal to pi. This is a computational way to say equals because we're using just a single equal sign to assign variables. But here we really mean, is 3.14159 equal to pi? And that is a true statement. You also learn a lot about functions. You give inputs to functions and they give you outputs back. The simplest function is print, which will simply give you back the value of a variable. So we can say print pi, and we can see that the print function gives us back 3.14159 from the variable pi. So that's about coding cells. You're going to learn a lot more about coding in the following lessons. Let's learn about the other type of cell, which is Markdown. So if we want to create a markdown cell, remember either we go up here and we select markdown, or we can convert between coding and markdown cells by pressing Y or M. Markdown is a type of code, but it's a type of code that gives you back a very nicely formatted text when you execute a cell. So let's say we wanted to create a beautiful type of heading. We can use, when it's a markdown cell, a hashtag will be a heading. Whereas in a coding cell, a hashtag is for comments and will be ignored by Python. So it matters if you have a markdown or a coding cell. One hashtag will give you a very large heading. Two hashtags will give you a smaller one. Three hashtags will give you an even smaller heading. Notice that I accidentally executed that cell, and now I'm on a new cell, but it's set to a coding cell. So I'm going to press M to turn this back into a markdown cell. And then four hashtags will give you an even smaller heading. So you can choose the heading style that you want. You can use underscores, for example, to create a dividing line using markdown. I hope you can see that. That's a very faint dividing line. You can write a lot of text. And you can use italics and bold using asterisks. And so one asterisk will make it italic. So we put an asterisk, and we put the asterisk before and after the text that we want to be italicized. So again, notice that it's not italics, even though I put it, because again, we're on a coding cell. We need to turn it to markdown, and you can see that as I write it, it's going to show it as italic, and then especially when you hit Shift Enter, then the text will be italic. You can also use an underscore to create italics. And we create this as markdown, and using underscore, we get that too. Two asterisks or two underscores will be bold. So we can use two, and this will be bold. You can put two spaces and an enter, and you'll get a new line. Remember, we can use underscores as well. Two of them will give you bold. This will be bold. Also, two spaces, enter for a new line, and then you can even do three. So three asterisks will be, this will be italic bold, two spaces, enter, or three underscores, this will be italic bold two, with three underscores. And you can execute those cells, and that's how you get bold and bold italic. You can also make lists. So let us create a list, and you hit enter. To make a list, it can be a numbered list, and you can just do one period space and just start creating the elements. This will be the first element. And then you can do two dot space. This will be the second. And three dot space, the third. And you can use two spaces and a asterisk to create a unmarked subheading. So if we press Shift Enter, you can see we have a numbered list, and we even have a subheading. You can even though create a unnumbered list just by using the asterisk, straight asterisk space first, asterisk space second, and asterisk space third. element. So that's how you get a unordered list. And importantly, you can create links as well. So to create a link, you can say for the link, click here. And the what you want the actual text to be that's hyperlinked, you use the square brackets. So click here, and we can say http://google.com, parentheses. And you can see it shows up as red. So if we shift enter that, and now we click there, we will be at Google. So that's how you create a link. There'll be a cheat sheet for how to use Markdown in the description of the YouTube video. So that's just the basics. That's how you use coding cells. That's how you use Markdown. Be sure to give your notebook a name. You can always save wherever you are and create a checkpoint by just clicking on the save icon. You can always download your notebook. If you've completed an assignment, you want to download it and send it to your instructor now, you go to File, Download As, and we're always working with IPython notebooks. And they have this very long extension. It's .ipynb for IPython notebook, IPYNB. And you just go to File, Download As, your notebook, and it should go to your downloads folder. If you, there'll be several notebooks that you'll have as assignments and that you'll need to upload into Jupyter to go over them as a lesson and review them. You can just click the upload video, the upload button here, and you can select the file, an IPython notebook that you want to upload. This is already in my home directory, so let's just call this example. So I'm going to upload this as example. This will be your first lesson that you'll be going over. You would upload the file, and then you can click it. And so, for example, this is what your first lesson will look like. And I hope now that you can see some of the really positive things that come out of using a Jupyter notebook. When you have these lessons, you can double click on the cells themselves, and you can see the all the code that goes behind it. Here you can see all the Markdown that goes into the formatting of all of the text. You will have cells that you can put your answers into for these lessons. And there will also be embedded YouTube videos that will go over these lessons. So let's see if I can turn off the sound. And if you'll notice that these videos are actually made using Jupyter notebooks too. And these videos are meant for you to follow along and go at your own pace. And if you ever need to go back and review something, pause, you can take all the time you need to review the material. That's the point of having these YouTube video tutorials in the notebook. So that is some of the basics of how to download Anaconda, how to load and get Jupyter started, the very basics of using Jupyter notebooks, of creating coding and Markdown cells, and how to upload and save your Jupyter notebooks. Thank you for listening.